I don't even want to say. I record everything I do, so I can tell you. I have a an app called Eternity, so I everything. I've recorded my sleep since 1999. I don't know. There's no good reason for this.
Just like when you go to sleep, when you but how can you?
You adjust a little bit. You know. You remember. Yeah, I mean, it actually, now I pretty much just, yeah. Yeah, no, you adjust these things, but it works pretty well, yeah. Big categories, kids, you know, yeah. Okay, so monologuing, okay. This is a movie that's out now, and I love this sort of thing, so I'm just showing you. This is crazy. There's a lot of, I think, the estimates of how much, human years went into making this thing. Which is mostly claymation, which is kind of amazing, I think, when you see this film. Anyway, that was just a prelude. Big stories. All right, so we're going to talk more about these power law size distributions. I'll show you the output from your estimates of wealth and so on. And there's a new problem set we'll go today about these power law size distributions. Yeah, I'll have to think of a fun name for it. Obviously, we have the theme sorted out. I spent too much time thinking about that, but for a while it was going to be Buffy the Vampire Slayer, but yeah. What's that? What's the theme now? The Princess Bride. Which you've seen, right? Right? Yes? Okay. So many people have not. All right. It's wrong. It's just wrong. The world has gone wrong. Okay. And then we're going to start talking about mechanisms that give rise to these power law size distributions, right? The scaling laws that I showed you earlier, there are all sorts of stories for them as well, but we're going to focus a little more on these power law size distributions. And I'll give you some sort of raw, random reasons for why they might appear, and then more mechanistic, defensible ones, which have really interesting histories associated with them, going back to the 1920s. Okay, that's great. And then forest fires, lots of other things. So, I think things are working, which is amazing. And I wanted to show you this button. Not that. That looks like it exploded. Excuse me. And we'll move office hours, I think, to 9 to 12 on Wednesday mornings. Does that help people in general? Okay. Yeah, okay. So it's just going to be a long session of complete madness. Okay. All right. So I'm going to give you some more examples of a list of examples. So we've talked a little bit about this. Words, for example, right? These power law size distributions. If you randomly select from a dictionary, not from a book, but from a dictionary, and then, or from the lexicon for a corpus, right? The list of words that are in a corpus. Then you'll get one of these power law size distributions. Most of the time, half of those words you'll select will appear once, typically, in a book. So they're very small. And very rarely you'll get the, right? If you're just randomly selecting from the book or from the corpus, you get the a lot. But if you're randomly selecting from the dictionary, that's a different thing. So that's a very important thing. Are you selecting by size or by category, right? And so those two things will matter when we get to networks, in particular, growing networks. So we talked a bit about these things, right? And we got to here, and let me just start again here, I suppose. This is the frequency of, in this case, word, right? But it could be earthquake size, whatever, and I'll show you some examples. The raw, linear version of it looks like nothing is happening, right? There's just this big spike here. So this means lots of little ones. And it's true that on average, your samples give you small, you get a small average. And that's something we'll get to in a little bit. And if you put on a log-log plot, you start to see this, some structure there, and you start to see that maybe it's got this power law tail, maybe. Right. And then very important thing is to, because these are messy things, people keep arguing about them, right? How do you measure these exponents? And I'll show you some influential works, I suppose, in this. So the complementary cumulative, right? Cumulative distribution, you're integrating up to a value. This is integrating from that value up to infinity. And we'll have a little calculation about that later. It's a simple thing. But because it has this nice power law tail, then the integral will have a parallel tail as well, and the exponent will move by one, and we'll explain that properly. So exceedance probability, so we talked about vocab. Okay, so now I'm gonna get onto some examples, and many of them are set up in that exceedance thing, and you need to look to see what they're really doing. Okay. So this is Gutenberg, very famous, right? Gutenberg-Richter law, many orders of magnitude here. And it's in a complementary cumulative thing. So this is, you know, this is a bad, this is not a good distribution, right? This is a pretty bad situation. And in fact, this is a pretty, there's a minus one slope, that which is really fat, right? So that's not normalizable. If that kept going forever, then the integral of 1 over x is ln of x, and evaluated infinity is infinity, so that's bad. Of course, there's a cutoff eventually. Earth's crust, you know, there's actually some size to the Earth, right? So you can't get earthquakes of infinite size. But there are many. There's a little round off here, and this is a measuring thing, really. This is, we don't register the smallest ones. Well, we don't care about them so much. We'll actually not even have it. But there's, you know, 5-6 orders of magnitude. I don't know. I mean, I've had this for a while, but it turns out that this paper was essentially published twice. And one was in PNAS, and one was in, I mean, big places. One was a colloquium type thing, and then there was, we misunderstood what you meant. But they had different orders of authors, and anyway. So that was a bit awkward. We talked about publishing before being a bit of a strange space. That's bad. Anyway, but a good piece of work. Okay, so, you know, why does these things sort of matter? And of course, earthquakes, floods, natural disasters are all of these sort of stripes, in that there are, you know, relatively frequent small events, and then less and less frequent, larger and larger and larger, and it keeps going out. So this is, I mean, I can summarize this, but this is a piece from the New York Times, Kenneth Chang's, you know, great science writer. Earth spin being that's a serious earthquake. But there was this was a great tragedy in Japan. I mean, many lives lost, and the nuclear disaster that followed is still really an issue. There hadn't been a quake like that for hundreds of years. And what happens, of course, that's many generations of people. We have things written down about what to do and what not to do. And I'm not sure if it's here, but there were actually stones put into the ground. It's like, do not build any closer to the water, right? I mean, just boom, just don't do it. Carved it in, stone's gonna last for a while, so the plan was, let's make sure people know about this in many generations. But, you know, nothing happens for hundreds of years, hundreds and hundreds of years, and you're like, well. So, people tend to, start building again, and of course it led to a disaster. So this is a very hard thing, you don't have to read all this, this is a very hard thing to cope with in terms of public knowledge and public behavior. Basic safety stuff. And maybe I mentioned it, so there were some Italian scientists who ended up in jail, I don't know for how long, for saying that the earthquake that was going to happen next week wasn't going to be that bad, and it was worse than what they said. I mean, it is a very difficult business prediction. Of course, tremendous improvements, right? I mean, we do now, you know, we understand faults, we have lots of sensing and so on, so maybe eventually we'll be able to quantify things a little more. But this has been a great sort of area of research, great mystery in earth science. It's like, can we do this? Lots of models, you know, making up little earthquakey models, good fun things. But weird places. I'm gonna show you some weird ones, right? This is, so of course lots of data online now, recipes are online, right? So this is taking recipes and then looking at the ingredients, and then what's the fraction that have so you look at the ingredient, how many appear in at least k recipes. So that's a complementary cumulative again. It's not a great plot. I mean, this is a log. I think some of these are they don't quite say this is actually an exceedance probability. You can see the way it's cleaned up, right? In fact, it's complementary cumulative, so it can only increase this way. Yeah. So if it was a normal raw frequency, it would be much messier. Jim Bagro, who's here, was on, there were a couple of papers that appeared a few years ago. He's on one of them. It's to do with the flavors in recipes and sort of creating a network out of that. And so you have this nice thing, recipes and ingredients, right? So then you have a bipartite affiliation network. So it's like boards and directors, right? So you have directors and or the boards and the directors that sit on them, and you end up with connections across in interesting ways, right? Because you can then project onto the boards or onto the directors this network that's induced by their relationships, right? So someone sits on the McDonald's board and on 3M as well, and that connects those boards, right? And they're small entities, right? So there's real structural, you know, information flow there. This is a little more abstract, I suppose, but it's a nice thing. So one of those works was to show these networks of flavors, and you could see the sort of Western-Eastern divide, right? So that broadly speaking, Western recipes were more complementary foods, and then the Eastern ones are more opposing in nature. They're sweet and sour, right? There's a sort of a, you know, cultural thing. Anyway, we know those sorts of things, but it was a big data sort of piece to come out. And Lara Adamek, who's at Facebook, did some other work as well with Yura Lin, who's at Pittsburgh. Anyway, fun things. So there are fun things to play around with. And they looked at how well people liked the recipes as well, right? And so I think basically they showed that the more cooked it was, the more people liked things. You know, cooking, right? It's one of the great, pretty great moment in human history when we started to, we moved away from just like eating things that got struck by lightning and we figured out how to do the fire thing. It changed behavior, right? You could compact nutrients in a really good way. The potatoes were edible things. Suddenly, the deadly nightshade family became accessible, and so on and so on. All right. But it's nice to sort of see that in online things. Okay. So a couple of pieces. This is a paper we'll get to later on, and we'll have sort of a surprising update this year, actually, 60 years later. Herbert Simon, very, very famous character. So he's a Nobel laureate. I'll talk about him in economics, but was sort of hard to pin down. He was at CMU, Carnegie Mellon, and I don't know, he's a great sort of general scientist. But political science was sort of perhaps his main thing. Mark Newman, who is outrageously prolific, very famous, a physicist who's done a tremendous amount in networks, right? So he has a book on networks, which if you want a textbook, his book, is amazing, and just a huge amount. So this is all of us have been messing around with these power law things for a long time, but he has a nice kind of big paper here that you might like reading through. And then this is some work with Aaron Clauset, who's at Boulder, Cosmo Chalizio, I think, is at Michigan, on this whole nastiness of how do you measure these exponents, right? And trying to give a principled way for how to do that. I think that paper has been cited 3,000-4,000 times. It's 2009. So this has become the standard for doing things when you measure these exponents, right? So a nice bit of social behavior. Everyone makes everyone else do it now. All right. This is from Newman's paper. There's a lot of stuff going on here, but let me see if we can kind of get a few out, right? So word frequency up there, these are size distributions, right? So these are the top one is the number of words that appear however many times. And they're all complementary cumulative distributions. Yes, correct? Okay, so this is, that's for Moby Dick. Again, everyone avoids reading Moby Dick, but they're happy to chop it up. So that's this. So this is a bit specific. So citations to papers published specifically in 1981 up through 1997, right? So they're all growing, but they all had the same birth date, which is important. So of course the mode is zero or one, right? Very sad. And then it decays. And so there are some monsters out here, although that number 10,000 is not huge anymore. I mean, science just keeps growing. So we'll work through some papers that are 30, 40,000 citations. You know, they were published just before the turn of the millennium, and they've it's insane, actually. It's just crazy. Okay. Right, single papers that have many more citations than most scientists will ever get total. Web hits. So this will be a specific thing. So this is just a different. So this is just a number of hits on a, this is. So some of these will be rates, and you know some will be totals in different ways. These are books sold, and let's see how that works. That's number. Yeah, best-selling books. Yeah, okay, but it's for a period of time. This is from AT&T. So AT&T, you know, before the network stuff, so they were sitting on some pretty interesting network data, and they had a number of very famous pure mathematicians working there, Bell Labs and so on. They didn't quite get what we'll see comes out of networks, again, at the end of the 90s, things like the actor graph, which is a fun thing to play around with, right? If you, it's like the boards of directors. Two actors are in the same movie, then they're connected. Power Grid was a big data set that people got hold of. Okay, so yeah, again, this kind of thing. Earthquake magnitude we've talked about. This is weird, crater diameter on the moon, right? Strange things. So, you know, these can't be all related mechanistically, but maybe some of them are. This you have to at least start to think about some physics, but maybe it's just sort of a geometry argument. I don't have that one in my head. These are solar flares. What's this next one? So that's G H. Yeah, this is solar flares, gamma ray. This is this is wars. So this is intensity of wars. So this is Richardson's work that I mentioned, and this is normalized by number of war deaths per 10,000 people in a population. So that's a detail in how that was worked out. But this is a bad thing, of course. And we've done some work in this class actually on these issues with terrorist attacks, drone strikes and so on, trying to figure this out. The modern people working on this of note would be Aaron Clausett, who I just mentioned, and Neil Johnson at Miami. Yeah, who's a wandering Englishman. Okay, this is wealth and name frequency. This is last name frequency, right? So that's pretty bananas. I mean, is it first name or last name? It is family names, yeah. So first names have this kind of business as well, right? You get down to just the 1,000th most popular baby name for a year, and it's sort of moving into misspellings of sorts, right? I mean, there's like every version of Brittany at some point in the past, you know. They're not necessarily misspellings, but they just become moving away. You know, and there are a lot of, traditionally they say a lot of Michaels, right? There are a lot of Michaels. And we'll look at that, how that changed over time later on when we get to social contagion. Very enjoyable. Populations of cities. So this piece here is saying that the scaling's not good here, right? That's what these little pieces are. So these are pretty diverse. Some of these do or don't matter, you know, in sort of everyday life. I've mentioned these. These are just sort of putting some of the exponents on them. These are rough things, right? There should be big plus or minuses. Forest fires, you know, maybe, maybe not. Lots of ranges of errors. It's just giving you some of the exponents. So these, I should say, you know, these numbers will matter a lot, and we'll get to that soon. Citations of papers. We had the wealth. That's a maybe. Trunk diameters in forests. We'll talk about this because this is just sort of a funny thing. You don't normally teleport to any point in the universe, but if you did, then this would be a big thing to worry about. Most of the time, nothing happens. Now and then, trouble. Okay, because this is -2.5, and we'll see the exponent. If your exponent is between -2 and -3, then that's a very dangerous place to be, it turns out. Moon craters, we've had these. They are religious adherents and cults, right? So, I mean, yeah. So there's all of these, you could think about it this way. One thing that's behind many of these is there's some, maybe not the, well, moon craters is an interesting thing, but there's a growth aspect, right? They're growing in some way. There's some sort of agglomeration process. So that starts to suggest that maybe there are some universal kinds of mechanisms behind this, or at least toy ones that we can then play around with. This is an ecology one, right? So birders are pretty good and they're better at, yes? What's that? Oh, probability. Yeah, so, and yeah, they could be correlated in ways, but this is the idea that if you get a whole sample of these things, and then create a frequency distribution, then we'll call it P. Sort of, you know, moving across to suggest that you know, this could be a big N for number, right? But we're sort of moving across to saying, well, maybe there's this probability distribution we could get to from a mechanism. Species per genus, this is old work by Yule, that's the 1910s, I think, yeah. Okay, yeah, that's cool, the birds per species thing. Lots of others, right? So this is terrorist attack. I don't need to put in all these, but terrorist attacks. And again, the religious followers. So, you know, these things have been put together over time, and then something to show here is, so these are efforts to estimate the exponents, right? These are all these exponents. And we can get to this later on, but these are these p-values here, sort of a notorious object, the p-value, but these are set up in a way that this is the probability that a null model of a power law size distribution could reasonably produce this observed behavior, right? And as compared to maybe some others, so there's a low chance that it comes out here for, what is it, metabolic degree. So this would suggest that this isn't really a power law. Heavy tail distribution, but not really a good power law, similar to these. Okay, point is, many, many different realms. And we're going to explore a few, as I said, simple mechanisms that give rise to these things. Someone who's done very well talking about all of this is Taleb. I'm not sure if you guys know about him. Maybe. Is this a name? No? Who's been on Wall Street and basically is, I mean, when we talked to him a long time ago. When we talked to him, he'd made money on 3 days of his life, I think, because he shorts the world, right? So when everything goes to pieces, he does well. So most of the time, he loses a little bit. And then now and then wins a lot. Big fan of Mandelbrot. These books have become incredibly successful. He has one on randomness, Black Swan. Some others have come after, I guess. But this is very famous now. And so you have corporations trying to find black swans like hand over fist, right? And so the black swan framing comes from this idea you have power law size distributions, say, I mean, it's tied, this is what we're going to tie it to, that now and then you get these really big events. And they're unexpected. So we'll sort of explore that a little more. He has sort of a fun framing of mediocre standard and extreme extent. So this is the normal distribution kind of world or finite variance things versus power law size distributions, and mild versus wild is a Mandelbrot framing. And height and wealth are the sort of classic examples. So the black swan is that story actually comes from Western Australia? Did I talk about this? So Western Australia, right? So Europeans are invading the rest of the world, and at some point they end up in Western Australia and find black swans, right? And there are white swans everywhere else you find swans, but these ones are black swans. And they come back and apparently say, this is amazing. This surely can't be true, because if you go to Australia and take a look around at the organisms that you find there, this is not the most surprising thing. You come back, and if people who came back with a platypus apparently, they were accused of stitching it together, right? Because people have done that as well. They're onto this whole game of making chimeras out of, half a panda and something else, right? And some ducks, just stitching them up and saying, putting in front of the Royal Society and whatever the English like to do. Anyway, so it's a strange thing. So this is supposed to represent a completely unexpected event. But it's basically a swan, right? I mean, it's a swan on the inside. It would taste like a swan if that's your thing. It's going to behave like a swan. It's just, you make one, you just paint one. Very surprising things are the hoppy things and the very much the platypus. I'm a big fan of platypus. I mean, lays eggs, the whole thing. It's crazy, right? Poisonous. Yeah. electromagnetic, really good. Anyway, so this is weird. So but that's stuck. And now you have this silly thing of people trying, I want 3 black swans this morning, which is right, because that's how we're going to make a ton of money. So that's completely wrong. That's not how it works. You don't find them hand over fist. But I'm sure there are trading companies called Black Swan, such and such. Okay, that's got out of hand. This is from his book, talking about this is a thing he likes to go on about. And it's true, if you have a power law size distribution of events, the past doesn't really help you if you don't really know you're in that world. You're sampling. Most things are small, and then you get a terrible surprise, right? If it's a normal distribution of events, that just starts to fill in. You start to see the normal distribution, and you're like, okay. So you're set. Nothing ever bad is going to happen. And somewhat famously, long-term capital, which is a disaster in terms of financial investing. This is the 90s, I think is right. Nobel laureates involved, and they had Gaussian assumptions in their financial models, right? Everything explodes. It was an arbitrage thing to do with currencies. Everything explodes because there was some interlocking of currency movement. They lose an unbelievable amount of money, but then attribute it to like a 7 sigma event, right? So it's still Gaussian, but it was a 7 sigma event. It's not true. If it's a parallel size distribution kind of thing or a heavy tail, then it's just something that happens every, whatever it is, 10 days, 100 days, 1,000 days. This is, so this is the progress for a turkey, right? So this is weight of turkey. And then this is Thanksgiving, right? So predict the turkey's idea of, he's a funny guy. All right, so, this is good, right? So it's not a bad thing. So typical member is mediocre. The typical one is either giant or tiny. It's sort of true, but that's true. We'll see that the mean is either tied to the upper scale or the lower scale of the system. Winners can take all in these situations. So they're very different kinds of behaviors. Again, as I said before, if you've been sampling from things, you're fine with normal type distributions. You're in trouble with the parallel ones. Prediction is quite hard in that case. Maybe. And this is not unreasonable, right? So the rare and they're the things that change the world. And if you have parallel size distributions, that's where you are. Okay, some other things. And then we'll get a few little calculations. So if you're in economics, Pareto distributions is what people call it. So he was looking at wealth at the end of the 19th century and found these, again, parallel size type distributions. The 80-20 rule sort of falls out of that, which is kind of related to this, the 1% idea as well. We'll have a little, this is actually a very nice calculation you can do with that, and we'll get to that in an assignment. But that's, it's hard, right? This parallel size distribution, we like to end up, if we can get it down to one number, then we'll do it, right? We'll do it. So this is a simpler thing to communicate. Whatever it is, 90% of the work is the last 10% of the time, like that's an encoding of it potentially. 1% of the people have whatever it is, percent of the wealth. Then there's 0.1% and 0.01%. You want to know the whole story. Dismal science, right? Which I always thought meant it was a bad science, but I guess it's right. I still think that, but it's to do with the kind of predictions that were coming out of economics early on about humans, that they were not fun things to think about. All right, so actual calculation. Okay, so I'm trying to convince you these things are everywhere. And they're left out of a lot of things. You won't see it in a lot of statistics courses. No one talks about it. They're considered to be pathological, right? So in fact, when we see them for degree distributions in networks, early work on it said, let's play around with these things. Let's just make them up, but they're pathological. They don't exist. In fact, they're everywhere, right? Weird. Okay, so we've got this thing. We're going to assume it's a very nice, clean one. It's continuous. You can do this calculation. It's not hard. It's just computing the mean of a distribution. And this is the sort of thing that comes out. So providing gamma is not equal to 2, then you have to do a little correction. So the maximum and the minimum scales appear, right? And depending on gamma, you have to be a little careful with gamma, right? So if gamma is less than 2, right? So again, it's defined as a minus gamma. So gamma is less than 2, so that means it's a little bit fatter like this. Then this dominates, and this thing will be small as you consider this scale becoming quite large, right? 2 minus a number that's smaller than 2. This dominates, and this disappears. So your typical member is going to be tied to the upper scale, and this is going to be a large number. If gamma is greater than 2, then this thing decays and disappears, right? To a negative power here. And then this thing flips. This is a smaller piece. So it's going to be tied to the lower cutoff, and that's what this is saying here, right? So as your gamma increases, the higher moments start to become finite. But in principle, for the parallel size distribution, if you have no upper limit, right, if this thing goes to infinity, there is a point at which your moments, right, which is the average of x to the n, that's the nth moment, becomes infinite. There's always a higher moment at which becomes infinite. So this is a good question to work through, simple thing. So 2 is a cutoff then for these exponents for whether you have whether your mean is infinite, so if this goes to infinity, x max goes to infinity, if we just allow it to become very, very large, then the mean goes to infinity. And we'll see a good example of that. That seems odd, but you can have distributions that are completely fine, they're normalized, right? The probability of things happening adds up to one or integrates to one. But the average of those things is infinity, which is weird. I'll show you a very odd example for that. Once it's above two, then this is, now it's finite, so your mean is finite, it's not so bad, or it's tied at least to the smaller cutoff. But when it's between two and three, the variance is infinite still. So that's generally speaking, the kind of disturbing power law size distribution situation where the exponent is between two and three, minus two and minus three, if you like. You have a finite mean, so most of the time you're sampling things that are pretty small, but the variance is infinite. So the potential for getting something enormous is huge. And when I say infinite, you know, it's tied to this. It's large. Okay, and I've said these things, so all the moments depend on the cutoffs. And these are the words that, yeah. Okay, so many real size distributions have this, and it's a bit of a scary business, right? And we'll say the width of the distribution or the variance is infinite. Even if it's just, there's a maximum cutoff. It's not infinite. You'll hear people say it. It's large, right? Fair enough. Okay, once gamma gets greater than three, now you have a finite mean, you have a finite variance. That's not so bad, right? It's not so bad. But the, you know, if it's a perfect power law with infinite, you know, with no cutoff, then the higher moments are infinite. But you can get a lot of, there you get into some confusion, right? It could really be some other kind of distribution and things get messy. They're messy already, but now they get messier. All right. Okay. Another thing to sort of think about here is variance is nice, right? You put an x squared in, integrate that thing. That's your second moment. And then you subtract off the mean squared, right? So that's the variance of a thing. I don't know if you need me to write that down. Right, it's the average of x minus mu squared. I like to write these brackets for averages of things, which is sort of a physics thing, which you can figure out, of course, is the second moment minus the first moment squared. So what are we trying to do with this thing? Well, we're trying to, you know, we've got a mean, and we want to look at how far away on average, right, that's what we'd like to know. How far away is our variate on average from the mean, right? Is it a narrow distribution or a wide distribution, right? That's a good basic question. In fact, we'd like to do this probably, right? We'd like to find the average of just the absolute value. That would be nice, but that's a nasty thing analytically. So we tend to avoid that. And this thing works well. It's perfect with the normal distribution, for example, very nice, right? So that, and there are other properties, variances add and all sorts of things. So that turns out to be what people work with. So this is just a small piece to say that, in fact, if you do this, if you do compute this mean average deviation, then you actually get a finite thing for this part where the variance is infinite. So in this respect, it's a bit complicated. The width isn't exactly infinite or large. But this is a hard thing to work with, so we tend not to use it. Just a little aside. Okay. All right, this goes with the sampling problem. So you're sampling, so extremal statistics, very nice thing, right? So you take n samples from a distribution, find the largest one, do it again, find the largest one, do it again, find the largest one, and then you have a distribution for the largest one after n samples, right? Beautiful mathematical theory involved with that. And there are three limiting distributions, actually, for what it could be. There's a Fréchet, Gumbel, what else? So anyway, you can do this sort of by hand. We can figure out what the largest sample will be approximately, and that's what this is going to be if we rank them. It's going to grow like n to the 1 over gamma minus 1. Now, if you have something like a normal distribution, then, and this is, say, this is for an exponential, the largest one is growing very slowly, like log n. grow even slower for a Gaussian, which is an e to the minus x squared, like that really dies away. You know, you have to wait for the entire run of the universe before you get something very, very big, like your seven sigma or whatever it is. But this is a power law, right? So this is, so if gamma equals two, that's that cusp of where the mean is infinite. This is growing like n to the one. So you're sampling and then it's getting larger and larger and larger. You just keep seeing larger and larger things. Gamma is three, which is the cutoff for getting a finite variance, n to the half, right? N over one to the three minus one, n to the half. So it's still growing. So all powers of gamma, all values of gamma here greater than one, which is the full scope, you've got a slowly growing maximum value. It's always getting away, right? It's not growing like a log, it's growing like a power of n. So whatever history you have, like however many samples you have, you are still going to have to, you're going to have to be very smart and realize that this power, that you're growing a power law, right? They tend to do this. They tend to just, as you sample more from it, this is a log-log plot, you start to see this, you start to see this, right? But it could be a situation where there really is a cutoff. So these are hard things to deal with. And a disaster if you have 10 samples, 20 samples, or 100 samples, all right? So that's a good thing to figure out. Okay, so let's connect this to a very famous way of looking at sizes, which is due to Zipf, right? Zipf's law. Okay, so this is this complementary cumulative that I talked about, and I just told you that the exponent was related in a simple way, but this is the setup, right? So I'll use this notation. So this is a probability that if you sample from your distribution, that you get at least this value x, this little greater than or equal to, right? So the normal cumulative distribution would be a smaller than or equal to. Okay, so, and that's writing it out in a different way, and then one minus this character here, right? So this is, this thing we can do in a nice way, right, either one. But it turns out that this is the integral we want to write down. So this is the, right, we're integrating a probability distribution from x to infinity. That's the probability that it's at least x. We have to worry about greater than or equal to. Not too hard, okay, right? Because it's just a little power. So we put in our form, there's a proportional to, there was some constant. It's blob to the minus gamma. Do this integral, right? We like these things. Good calculus, very simple thing, right? Minus gamma plus one down here. Yeah, this would come back to give us this. Evaluated at infinity and this beast. And as long as gamma is greater than one, which it has to be for normalization, you can see the explosion would happen here. Then at the top it's at zero, right? This is a minus power here, right? So a negative power, so this is zilch. And then we just evaluate it at x. And if you think of it, so this is a negative actually, right? This is a negative quantity here. So things clean up, we get a positive thing, it's positive, minus gamma plus one. So we started with a power law size distribution with a minus gamma, and now we've got minus gamma plus one, right? So if it was three, now it's a two. The exceedance probability distribution is again a power law, and it has its exponent shifted by one. And the exceedance, or the complementary cumulative, is much cleaner because it is an integral, right? Integrals clean things up. Differentiation smashes them and makes them more fractured. So it's cleaner, as you saw in the slides at the start, and we can do regression on that and get our exponent. We get minus gamma plus one, and then we fix it up to get gamma. Okay? Okay? Yeah? Or you can do the same thing with exponentials and other kinds of distributions where there's a tail that you're looking at. Good. All right. So you use it when the tail, when you really believe you have a tail that's following a power law, the exponent goes up by one and it cleans up data. And this was our example, right? This is the PDF, the raw PDF. Again, this is for the Brown corpus, word frequency. And that's the integrated version. Again, integration smooths things, makes them nicer. So, yeah, there's some stuff to worry about here, right? This is a little jumbled, but this is reasonable. Usually the tail has something funny going on about it, right? This is the most common one. This is the, or it might be the biggest city. Biggest city, depending on, so this is something we've been looking at again. People have looked at this. The biggest city in a country might fit well in these distributions. Sometimes it's off, though. It's a bit different because of history. And yeah. Okay. Good? Okay. All right. So discrete variables work in the same way. Right, so now we just have this thing, it's growing, it's just k equals 1, 2, 3, 4. So we just have a sum instead of an integral. And of course, because we like integral-like calculus, depending on what we want to do, we'll usually mess around with that and turn it into an integral anyway. But you get the same basic story. Use integrals to approximate sums. So the same story there. But okay, so let's connect this to ZIF. So that's a good sort of mechanical thing. Pretty much all of the methods for measuring these exponents work on the complementary cumulative, which again just has this nice property, Powell law, simple change in the exponent by one. So ZIF, whose work is kind of extraordinary. I mentioned him at the start. I guess I'll talk about him again, maybe in a bit. But he has this. Famous book of his, very interesting to read today, and we're going to talk about Zipf's law. But what came to be known as Zipf's law, he died the next year when he was about 50, from what I can gather. He was a linguist at Harvard and specialized in Chinese and some other languages, Native American languages as well, I think, was sort of a thing for him. So he was looking at vocab knowledge, right? So as kids grow, they learn words at a certain rate, and what's the distribution of how they use them? So that's in there as well. But he started to look at all sorts of other things, and I'll show you some plots, but things like city sizes, the amount of freight that's moved between cities, mentions of people in newspaper articles, and it seems clear that he got hold of a lot of students to do this and forced them to be his computers. But if you read his thing, he's like, well, we should be able to do this like the natural sciences, right? We should be able to measure all this stuff. And anyway, he has this kind of Homer Simpson principle, which we'll get to. But basically, the idea that people mete out their effort such that it minimizes how much energy they'll expend, right? It's not unreasonable. But this is what he did. This was his simple. People weren't talking about probability distributions like this or these size frequency distributions. Very simple things. This is very easy to do. If you have a list of, say, city sizes or frequency of words just sitting in a text file, this is, and you have access to something like any basic thing, Python or whatever, you just rank them. Very simple thing to do, right? So the first one, rank one, will be the largest one, and so on. And you just rank them. And then when you get to ties, you just put them all in the line. Doesn't matter. So X1 in this case would be the frequency, so the size. So for language, it's the frequency of occurrence, the population of a city, the number of species in a genus, right? The most populous genus, if you like. And he made this observation that this too has this Powell law decay, and we'll put an alpha here. So I'll try to keep these. These are coded into the LaTeX. This is / zip alpha or something like that. So we'll use that, and we'll use the gamma for the size frequencies. So sizes decaying is out of the minus alpha. Very good. And as I said, you'll see people kind of measuring both of these things, frequency distributions and zips as well, and measuring the exponents and talking about what they are. And his general observation was that this is not always true, of course, and that there's a lot of minus one stories out there that decays relatively slowly. All right, so let's connect this to size frequency distributions, because you can. So this is the CCDF thing that I was talking about, and this is ZIF. And if you look at this, for this little example of vocabulary, they have a similarity. Right, if you just look at it, you start to think. So there are many more back here, right? This is the low frequency ones, the ones that appear a little bit. This is the word the and of. And then they're flipped around because now the is at the start, yeah, and then of, right, and this is their size. So, right, these are, and you can see this little structure here is starting to give some things away. And if you do this really properly, right, then there should be little slopes here, yeah, because it's really a probability distribution. All right, so they are the same if you, related, they are the same if you flip them, right? So that's what I'm trying to do there, flip. So if we flip these axes, it's the same story. So let's kind of just work through that and connect these two exponents. All right. Yeah, and so this wasn't widely kind of acknowledged. I mean, this is a simple thing that I'm telling you, but it wasn't widely sort of understood, which seems a bit odd, until about 2000. You see people quite independently measuring these pieces. And one of my favorite, at least in terms of authors, Flutos, the early study of the World Wide Web structure, when we call it the World Wide Web. Or people from Pittsburgh would say, W. I'm related to those people. very funny. Okay, from downtown. So let's see. So let's connect these things. So this is our probability distribution, and we'll just sort of multiply by n to get our number of things, because now this is going to be a frequency distribution again, right? We're just going to multiply by capital N. It's rough. It's a rough thing to do. So this is going to be the, let's say this probability. So this is a number of objects with, it's the exceedance probability. So let's sort of interpret it properly. It's a number of objects with size at least X. So that starts to feel a bit like a rank. And if an object has size XR, whatever it is, this could be a word or a city, right? So it's frequency of a word, population for a city, then it's rank, because it's the number of things that are bigger than it. You know, it's rank plus one or whatever it is, doesn't really matter. So just think about that. It's just a little piece, right? So now we've got them connected, really. So this is the size frequency distribution multiplied by n. So if you integrate over this thing, you get n, which is the total number of objects. So roughly speaking, this is then going to be, if you evaluated it at some size, this will give you an estimate of the number of objects that are bigger than it, which is then its rank, right? Because when you do the zip way, you order them by size. Okay, so then we just do a tiny bit of algebra. So this is Zipf's observation that the rth object, according to size rank, decreasing size rank, decays out of the minus alpha. And we're going to put this object in here, or this piece in here, for its rank, right? So this is from the size frequency distribution, R replaced by that with the minus alpha. And then we know how this behaves. This behaves as minus gamma plus one. So that's this piece here, right? That's the decay of the exceedance probability, or the CCDF, right? So the n is just proportionality. All of this blob got replaced by size to the power of minus gamma plus one, and then there's a minus alpha on top. We started with x to the r, so all of this has to be one. Right, there's the form for the CCDF. All of this has to be one. X of r is proportional to x of r to blob, so this blob is one. One equals blob, and we can invert it, and we get alpha equals one over gamma minus one. Nothing too crazy, right? So the Zipf exponent is often 1, and that would correspond to gamma equals 2. So, and gamma equals 2 is this extreme example where you're on the cusp of infinite mean, finite mean. Okay, so it's a pretty, so the classical Zipf distribution is a fairly extreme situation. All right, so that's a nice little connection to have. As I said, yes, good, okay. I'll show you this. This is for fun, because this is just about extreme statistics. And then I'll show you the little bit about the your estimates and how they've kind of changed over the last few years. Cricket, I like cricket. I know you're all test cricket fans. It's the greatest storytelling sport machine there is. 5 days, 6 hours a day, which is pretty insane. But this is, so John Bradman is from the bush in Australia and was, you know, sort of this gargantuan of the time, played from the 30s, and there was the Second World War, he did play after that. But, you know, he would go to England and they couldn't get him out, right? So he'd bat for a day or something and make an unbelievable amount of runs very fast. It's very different to baseball, it's just a different game. But the newspaper the next day would say he's out, right? Like, that would be a huge thing. Like, this guy was, they couldn't figure out what to do. Anyway, you get averages in cricket, like all these other sports, it's full of numbers. And in cricket, you'll make, if you make 100, that's very impressive, right? So you remember, that's recorded in your statistics, how many 50s you've made, how many 100s, you wave your bat, to the crowd. So his average ended up being 99.94, and that's him there. In terms of sports, right? I mean, this is pretty interesting, and this is everyone else. So there are three people who've ended up, you know, after a number of games, you need a sort of small, you know, there's one person who made 100 and I think either never played again, may have become deceased for some reason, so I'm trying to remember, it's early on in the history of cricket. So, you know, once you put enough things, no one has an average that's close to this. This is really, really strange. You know, Michael Jordan, all these Gretzky, I mean, those people are right at the top, but they are on the tail. So this is just a very strange thing. So I don't know if that will ever, it's just unthinkable that that would change. I mean, it's changed a lot recently, the game. So it's pretty good. Batting average is quite different. So in terms of extreme statistics, yeah. So we'll get to Mona Lisa and things like that later on. I'm not going to show you this. There's a video here, and it won't work anymore. So I used to be able to embed these in PDFs, which was an insanity, right? But it doesn't, I don't know, it just changed. I can't do it anymore. It's just a tragedy for me. But basically, I'll tell you what he did. This is, I don't know why people don't do this, because say soccer, you know, Brazilians are great at soccer and they play indoor soccer, right? Yeah, yeah, and it's with a slightly heavier ball. So you're doing a different thing. You're playing a different game, but that helps you when you get out, it seems, yeah? And this he would play with a, so in cricket you have wickets, which is just a round bit of wood with a golf ball against a corrugated tank. He would just hit the thing back and forth. Basically insane, right? So, but there is an old video of him doing that and then throwing golf balls at things. So he, you know, there's a story for how he trained himself in this kind of interesting way. All right, so, okay, that's good. So this is the last piece to add for this, all these slides. So these are your estimates of the wealth inequality or the, by quintiles in the world. You see, not everything added up. And that may be my glitch, but there were definitely a couple that went, okay, let me say this. This is the estimate of the actual, right? And that was pretty good. You guys did pretty well in terms of understanding. Well, did better than people did a few years ago. And let's see. I mean, they weren't too bad. This is 2013, not too bad. It's not super dissimilar. Yeah, but yeah. A lot more of the, everyone should have exactly the same amount. and then a little bit over here, and presumably the economists are up in this area. That's a pretty big variation. So I guess it's not in that paper, right? I mean, the individual responses, but, you know, the average kind of comes out like this, and I don't think Scandinavia does this. No, I don't know. Right, okay. Hard thing to think about. So I guess I've mentioned things like there's the 80-20 rule, there's the, now we have this kind of 1%. The 1% thing is funny though, because it's just 1%, right? It doesn't tell you what the 1% have, like that's not built into that little statement, but it just says there's an us versus them, sort of, right? Maybe, and it's pretty easy to say. It could be the 0.01% might be better, but that's harder to say. But it doesn't tell you what's going on with that. Actually, a number that I haven't mentioned here, but a number that's used over and over again for inequality is the Gini coefficient, right? And so we'll get to that later on when we talk about entropy a little bit. But that's, again, taking this big, crazy distribution and turning it into one number, which, you know, not so helpful. Okay. Yeah, I think there's a little more of the, yeah, you could see, here it is. This is the Bernie Sanders, like, grassroots is growing, right? Yeah, it's good. This one, see, that's, I just put them in faithfully. See, that's not right. That can't be true. And I got the sense, actually, from some answers that, because I didn't include them, but there were some that had 10 and then 30 or something like that, right? It has to go down, but maybe I'm wrong, but it felt like it's like this, it should transition, like the money should be taken away from those people. Okay, I don't know. The numbers have to go down. All right, so very good. And we've got a little bit, so we can start on thinking about some of these mechanisms for why these kinds of distributions come about. And I'll give you a sort of a famous one and a very surprising one to start with. Let's see if this works. Yeah. So it's going to be about the first return problem for random walks. A very famous character here is Polya, who will come back later on when we look at the rich gets richer stuff. First return. And so just a random walk. You have a random walk wandering around in one dimension and just taking one step every time. Time step, right? Just one step, and it's a random step. Flipping a coin. Yeah, just let them go. And you can do it in two dimensions, three dimensions, play around with these things. And they have applications. There's a lot of randomness in the real world. I'll show you some examples. Connects to the all sorts of mathematical things. Of course, the normal distribution, as I'll show you. But the question for the first return is, what's the probability that this walker returns to the start after t time steps? So because of the discreteness of it, it has to be an even number, right? So odd numbers, they have to be on an odd position. So if they start at zero, then they go to plus one or minus one, right? That's fine. So it's after some even number of time steps. And so you'd think, well, for a start, right? So they're going to walk away, and then 50% of the time, they'll come back, right? So 50% of the time, they come back within two steps. So what's the average? So maybe just think about this. What's an estimate of the average time it would take for all of these walkers to return? So you let a whole bunch, infinite number go, and then when they come back, you know, you clock how many come in at that time, and then average those return times. Think about that, right? So 50% come back within two steps. And then another way, and this will connect into the forest fire stuff, is that you could have mild distributions, but then there's just some simple power law relationship that gives you a distribution for something else that has a power law size related to it. Now, so these are kind of, that's a structural thing, this is randomness, and then the next set of slides we'll talk about more mechanistic things like growing models, which I've talked about being kind of clearly pervading through all of these systems where you've got many, many sizes of things that you're, you know, even language, right? You start off with a small vocab in a language and it starts with ook. You've got ook, ook, and then you maybe get a different variation of ook, and then eventually you have a language. Okay, so random walks. This may mean nothing to anyone. Maybe? A little bit? Okay. Okay. That's a pretty great moment in the history of television. Okay, so we're going to go to these places, and you've seen these things, and then the very different worlds. Okay, so this is a big deal, right? Randomness gives rise to structure. We tend to think of it as a bad thing. Lots of engineering things have been about getting rid of it. But you can harness it in all sorts of good ways. And random walks are the great example. So we're going to have, as I said, this one very simple one where you can just take a step, plus one, minus one. And time will just be 0, 1, 2. Time is discrete. You can vary this in all sorts of ways. But this is the essential story. Let's see what we get out of this. So there's just a few runs, right? So this is the casino. You can think of, it's basically true, actually, although it's got a little bit of a deviation, so the house wins. But these are just a few walks. And this is displacement from the origin in the vertical axis and then 10,000 time steps. So just flipping a coin, 50-50, right? No biases. And this first return problem that I talked about, right, coming back here, and then lots of coming back here and coming back. So this is not first return. This is just returning to the origin. So we can think about that. But actually, long period where, right, in that one example, if this is a game and you're losing, you know, it's about money, right? This is how much money you have versus the person you're the entity that you're competing with. When do you stop? What should you do, right? If you get in front, what's the expected time from here for you to become even again? That sort of thing. Yeah. At some point, too, in Las Vegas, right, it went from, so there used to be the one-armed bandits, right? You had to pull them, right? You had to actually physically pull them. And then there's buttons, so you could just do that. But each bet, you had to actually push a button. And then it became, you could just push a button, and the credit card's in there, you just push a button, and then you watch this just unfold. So, not great. but an excellent way for voluntary tax to be paid. So, all right, that's just a few examples, random walks. So, lots of structure though, right? I mean, if we're trying to tell stories about things, this is, you know, this is the financial market, then sure, we can tell you why it's going up and down. Okay, very simple things. It's just a few simple things. So displacement after t time steps, we're just adding up these little variables that have, they can be plus or minus one with probably a half each. So the average after time t, quite simply, we're going to average the sum, which is the sum of the averages, and on average, they don't go anywhere, right? So zero, fine. So on average, at time t, we expect this has to be an even, we're assuming even numbers. I mean, this is true, but generally we'll assume even numbers. We expect and the framing here is often used for random walks, that we have someone who's drunk too much, and they're back at a pub, all right? So we expect them to be back, right? That's what we expect. They should be there. There's no bias here. All right, odd numbers of steps would be an issue. We know they can't be back. I mean, what do you expect? I don't know what you expect. I'm not sure what you expect. But you'd think, you know, if they get away a little bit, well, but you expect that they, you know, mathematically you expect that that's where they are. They're back at the start. All right, so some weird things happen here. So this is a sum rule for variances. I sort of critiqued variances a little bit before, but one of the great things about them is you sum them up if you have independent random variables. So the variance of this displacement at time t is going to be the sum of the variances. And the variance for each one of these, right? How do we compute variance? It's a simple thing. So we have probably a half times plus one squared. So this is the mean of epsilon squared, if you like. So the second moment. That's all it is, plus a half minus one squared. Right, so that's just one. And then we subtract off the mean squared. Fine, nothing too crazy here. And that's one minus zero equals one. So, right, nothing crazy. So we're summing up ones, right? So at time t, this is the variance that for our displacement. So this is a famous aspect of random walks, is that the standard deviation grows as t to the half. Diffusion systems, which this is part of, this t to the half thing is there. So this is a nice little scaling law. It's a nice little scaling law. This is a, right? I'm not going to call it allometric scaling, but it's a nice little scaling law. And you can think of this as, what's this little system? Well, it's kind of an aggregation thing. It's an additive process. That's all it is. We're just adding. We remember where we were, right? That's all. We remember how many beans we had, and then we add or subtract a bean, yeah? Okay, so that's a nice thing. That's a good thing. Okay, so I want to show you this video, but I know it doesn't work anymore, so let me get it out of here. All right. Okay, a couple of things. This is pretty good. So an old... Oh, I'm in the wrong spot. Sorry, coming. Two screens really is too confusing for me. So this is sometimes called a Galton machine. Galton's the one who walked around trying to calculate how good looking everyone was. Did some other things we'll talk about. Can you see this? So these are random walks coming down, and then there's a, you know, stopped at some time, and then there's a little ball, right? I'll try and speed it up. So we had them going this way, now they're going down this way. Right, famous example, and I don't know if this will speed up enough. The probability of each specific path is a half times a half times a half, right? If it's of length t, so they're all distinct, but the probability they end up at the same spot, well, that ends up giving you a normal distribution, right? Which is a good little calculation to work out. This is a bit slow. There's a Galton, sometimes called the bean machine. Here's another one. Let's make this go faster. How do we get it to go faster? There are actually, some people have made all sorts of contraptions, physical contraptions, which you can find online, and then they sort of put in like two small, like tiny little beads, and then it doesn't work actually. They just go scatters everywhere. But this is, of course, a numerical thing, so it's going to do the right thing. So a 50-50 chance of going anywhere. So you start to get, so this is the Pascal's triangles here, and binomials and all sorts of other things, right? So it connects to all sorts of other mathematical things. You can't see this, but this shape is going to be a normal distribution. Quincunx is another word for it. These things have been around for a long, long time. Okay, good. Okay. The bean machine. Bean machine. Put beans into it. Should I do this? This might not be... Okay. This is from Plinko. Price is Right. This one should work. That's funny. It got stuck. I don't know why that's muted, actually. I don't know. Yeah. I don't know why that's stuck. No idea. Sorry. So they had this ridiculous thing, right? And I don't, the numbers are a bit funny at the bottom, but it landed on, it got stuck on a thing. There you go. Yeah. Yeah. That's unlikely, right? Nice to see it in things like this. Ridiculous. I don't think I can get it. Yeah, I used to be able to do it, but tragically it's been taken away from me because of API problems or something. I don't understand. What's that?
What happens?
So there is, the printable version doesn't have it. There's a switch that takes it out. I think it gives you a dead page. Like it gives you a little box. Yeah. You should try it. You should try it. Just destroy your printer. This I don't really want you to hear. Anyway, so people make machines, right? And they try to explain the stock market. And in fact, these red bars here are returns from a particular investment or something, right? So it's a nice display of that. Okay, but we could jump through. And we don't need to see all the gears. Normal distributions, that's what comes out of it. So it's a nice game to figure out that that is in fact true mathematically. So you guys can work on that. But let me just set up the next piece. Yeah, I'm having to remove all those things. Okay. All right, fine. In a few more minutes, we'll talk about this. We'll just set this up. So as I said, right, a specific walk has a chance 1/2t of appearing, the specific walk. But walks that appear end at the same place, well, then there are many, right? So there's only one that ends out here, which was always left, 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 right, very unlikely, and one that went right. I've got that round the wrong way. There's only one of them, but the one that's in the middle, that has the most chances. Right, so the same place. So we'd like to think about this. So you start at position I, end at position J, after, and you have T time steps. So what's, you have to count how many there are. So that's a little question for you to figure that out. So it turns out to be a binomial. It's T choose this blob. It's not too hard to figure out. So we're going to do some counting, but then there's a, yeah, okay. Some basic counting, all right. So we're going to do even numbers of steps, right, fine. So the displacement can either be zero or an even number. So what's the probability that it gets to 2k after 2n time steps. So we've got this this expression, you can go back to the previous page, it's going to be proportional to this binomial, and then for large, so this is a problem to sort through, this thing tends to this blob, which is a nice result, very nice result. Seems, so a bunch of factorials in here, factorials, for large factorials, what do we use? We pull out, what's our, you don't have to know this just yet, that's all right, but what's there's something in a box, we go through the box. In fact, you probably have it in your pocket. You should have it in your pocket. Next to various other simple things like, L'Hopital's rule or something like that. This is So large factorials for large n, you use Stirling's approximation. Okay. Okay, good. All right, so Stirling's approximation is what you play around with here. So this is good. It's very nutritious. There's a whole other world here that I'll just point to, stable distributions. Of course, this is the central limit theorem. Gives us this. This is one way of just seeing it for a very specific mechanism. Stable distributions are... So one of the things about a Gaussian, for example, if you convolve Gaussians with themselves, then you get another Gaussian, various other properties, right? So if we add variates to the Gaussian distributed, we get another one. But there's a whole family of, or a whole set of other distributions that have that property. They're called stable distributions, and they all have power law tails, right? There's an inverse Gaussian, Laplace's distribution, other things. Anyway, so that's another world. But they're kind of hard to see as arising from simple mechanisms. That's the story, right? We had this root t thing, here's time, our normal distribution is spreading out and spreading out and spreading out, and its width is growing like the square root of t. It's diffusion. Okay, I just want to set up, there you go, random walks. That's how you get to the snowballs. Okay, let me just set up, I'm just going to jump to this point here because we're going to have to finish. What's the probability that our random walker comes back after time t to the start? It turns out to be infinity, right? I mean, what's the average? What's the average time? Probably is two things. The probability is one, they will always return. They'll always return in one dimension. And then the average time it will take is infinity, which is pretty strange, right? It's a strange, strange result. And I will just jump to the thing that we'll start again on Tuesday with. Sorry about this. I should have had it written down. Okay, all right. Okay, it's not here. All I want you to know is that this is, because we're not going to get to it, the probability of first return is this thing. First return after, say, time 2n, t is time 2n, scales as 1 over 2n, to the 3/2. So this is our gamma, right? Gamma equals 3/2. So that's a pretty, that's an extreme kind of gamma. This is, it has to be at least one, it's less than two, it's an infinite mean situation, like well into the infinite mean category. So we'll figure this out. It's a nice problem. It's a lovely problem. But it is a counting problem. You have to do it. There's a sneaky way of doing it. There are other ways, you know, different ways to get this. But that's the idea. And then after that, we'll work on variable transformation, and then we'll get to these really fundamental mechanisms that you see kind of pervade all sorts of systems. But that's, okay, that's a good place. I'm going to give you another assignment. Okay, good. And it will be on the power law size distribution stuff, so not quite this. That's the next time around. Okay.